Absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, you have all the people that you are going to have for this evening. Ms. Watts has indicated that she was not going to be present.
Yep. Thank you. I think it's time to call the meeting order then. Good evening, everyone. The first order of business is to do our roll call, and I will ask folks to introduce themselves.
Aaron Sullivan.
David Schwartz.
Martha Schroeder.
Andy Doctorow.
Jill Plamper.
Mike Wright.
Sheldon Cohn.
Bob Paul.
Okay, and so we only have 8 people tonight. Kim is out of town, I believe, or can't attend. The only reason why I point that out is that it's still necessary to have 5 people approving it, even though there are only 8 people present tonight, 8 commissioners. So I just want people to know about that. We will have a motion, if anyone wants to make it, for the next item on our agenda, which is the approval of the agenda. Would anyone like to make a motion on that?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? The agenda is approved, and the next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes from February 27th, which has been presented to us. Any comment or a motion, either one?
Motion to approve as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any comment or concerns? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, the minutes have been approved. And the first, I would say, substantive matter is the matter of consideration of the expansion of the giraffe exhibit at the Detroit Zoo. And that is what we're going to talk about now. So who's here to present for the zoo?
You want to pass this? Or you want to? Oh, yeah, I didn't see you sitting here. I apologize.
I'm here from the zoo.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure. What I'm going to do, just to orient folks, and I'm not going to have my dates, is to give a chronological recitation of, I think, what has happened, because some people might be surprised that you were before us. And Hank, I'm going to ask you to correct me if I've got something wrong. Okay. Is that okay?
Yeah.
My recollection is that at a meeting several months ago, this commission engaged in some extensive discussion regarding whether or not we would exercise jurisdiction over site plans that are outside a certain length away from Huntington Street, on the theory that if it's in the middle of the zoo, which obviously is in Huntington Woods, it doesn't impact the health, safety, or lifestyle of folks in Huntington Woods living there. My recommendation is that there was fairly meaningful uniformity or consensus on that issue. We made that recommendation to the City Commission, and the City Commission apparently went its own way and said that everything on the zoo that falls within the boundaries of Huntington Woods shall be subject to a site plan. Notwithstanding, again, our recommendation saying that we didn't have the expertise or the time or the concern to go over things like giraffe exhibits. Be that as it may, that apparently was a decision of the City Commission. And then, for some reason that I'm not quite sure I understand, there was not approval of the site plan that is before us, and the zoo has already started construction on this particular expansion. Hank, and so right now we're kind of looking at something that's almost after the fact. You're looking for approval for something that's already begun. Hank, is that a fair summary, or am I missing something?
Yeah, it's actually fair, but I just want to point out specifically that the zoo had the zoo did apply for the permits.
Okay.
In the manner that they were supposed to. This in no way would really reflect on the zoo.
Not suggesting it does.
Participation at all. I just wanted to make that
okay.
Point. Other than that, if you're ready for them to go ahead.
Okay, yeah, and I just for your presentation, so the commission is fully informed, could you explain how it came to be that there was, you know, work done on an expansion prior to being approved by us, if you know?
Sure.
And I'm sure there was no ill will or bad faith. I just would like to know.
So first I'll introduce myself. I'm Jerry Van Anker. I'm the chief operating officer at the zoo. And my role, I'm in charge of all the construction at the zoo. And I'll just maybe even back up a little bit further. I guess it was probably 3 or 4 years ago. We went both to the city of Royal Oak and Huntington Woods and talked about the approval of our master plan. And if that master plan had been approved, any projects within that would pretty much be exempt from site plan approval. That if the commission, the city of Huntington Woods, was okay with our master plan, then site plan wouldn't need to be approved. And we went to several other municipalities and zoos and asked, you know, how they handled things, and that was pretty much the way the other zoos had handled it too. So both Royal Oak and Huntington Woods said they were okay with, as long as the master plan was approved, and which we brought before the commission here, and they seemed okay with it, that there wouldn't need to be a site plan approval, but we still had to pull permits and make sure that everything was done to code, which is, so that's why, if you wonder why we didn't have site plan approval for giraffes, that we were under the understanding that it wasn't required. So that's...
No, I'm suggesting any bad faith. I guess now...
That's about all
there
I
is really absolute
is.
Clarity that unless the
that's
city commission...
That's the extent of my presentation. I mean, I've got the master plan.
Okay.
I've got an executive summary of the master plan, which, you know, we've talked to even previously about, talked to the mayor about, and they thought that made sense. So I don't know if it's in your minutes somewhere or if there were prior approvals, but...
No, but what I would suggest that you do, just for the edification of the commission, is to explain what you're doing, what the nature of the changes are, and whether it does or does not impact the residents of Huntington Wood in any material way.
Sure. So what we're doing is adding to the indoor arena, almost tripling the size of it. So the current paddock is a third, and we're tripling it to... two-thirds as large as that. It was all a precast concrete construction, so there wasn't any, there were spread footings for precast was put up, large skylights in the top, and then the inside is just a real simple wood construction with rooftop units for HVAC, large windows, so giraffes can see out of them, about 12-foot tall windows. So. And then doors at the end with an outside paddock that's expanded, so there's more outside space there that they can then go into the old exhibit to be outdoors. So that's really the nature of it. It's a pretty simple construction and design.
And how far away is it, just so everyone knows, from Huntington Road?
729 feet.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Quite a ways. I mean, and I don't think, I didn't drive down Huntington Road to see if you can even see it, but I doubt that you can.
You can.
Okay. I can't see it. Yeah.
Okay. Is that your presentation?
That's all I was,
okay.
was asking.
And just for the sake, before we move on to mm-hmm. further comments, you know, until the city commission does something different, it's understood now by the zoo that it has an obligation to come to us with those site plan applications or expansions
okay.
before you undertake work, correct? You understand that?
If that's what you're telling me.
Yes. What I am saying
is... I guess the only thing I'd say is why.
Well, we can talk about that in a second.
Yeah.
After we go through this process, because I would like to ask some of the commission members about that issue. But until you hear otherwise, because I understand it's something that the city commission actually weighed in on, that we have to enforce the ordinance. The ordinance requires you to come before us for everything that's in Huntington Woods, even if it's out of eyeshot. And we can ask whether that makes sense, which I would like to talk about.
Okay.
But until the city commission says something else, please follow that procedure, okay?
Understood.
Thank you.
Yep. I just want to go on record as this is new news.
I'm not suggesting it's
okay.
Not to you, okay? I'm just making sure we're communicating.
I don't think we busted any rules before, so.
No one's suggesting there's
okay.
been anything intentional or anything like
okay.
that.
Thank you.
Just, we don't want a failure to communicate.
You know, we really have worked hard to have a good neighbor policy. And that's our full intention.
We've dealt with you before, and we have no doubt that that's true.
Okay. Okay.
So I will start with, well, before we start with commission comments or questions, does any member of the public have any questions or concern? Or Hank, do you want to talk about it first?
Whatever your pleasure is, if you want to take public comments.
Why don't you go first, Hank?
Okay. Basically what you're looking at is you're looking at a piece of property in Zone 4, which is Parks and Recreation District. It's the Detroit Zoo. Almost three-quarters of the zoo is within the corporate limits of the city of Huntington Woods. The property dimension contains approximately 125 acres. The closest point to the property line of this project is 729.9 linear feet. The lot area, which would include the entire zoo, is over 500,000 square feet, so it's quite huge. The addition size is 3,576.24 square feet, which is 0.081 of an acre, so it's quite small in the scheme of things. What it does do is it does allow them to have a larger space in which to house the giraffes, in which they can facilitate space to keep them, you know, during inclement weather or situations like that. Again, as was already expressed, they are precast concrete sections. The height from grade totals 29 feet. The list of the Zone 4 regulations for parks and recreation, it meets all the requirements of the Zone 4 Accessory Buildings and Structures Code. And for just a little bit of background on the zoo, on this particular exhibit, first I did include the table from the Schedule of Regulations, which show clearly that this is well within the confines of what's required. I did want to point out that the original giraffe exhibit was built under the direction of Heinrich Hagenbeck. And some of the background is that if you take a look at the way that the zoo was done, the Zoological Society, as I understand it, was formed in 1911 by three Detroiters, one of which you will recognize being Horace Rackham. And in 1916, 100 acres of Henry Farm was purchased by the Society and west of Woodward and Royal Oak in Huntington Woods. Then Mayor James Cousins encouraged the voters to accept the gift of the property by the Society with the added incentive that an anonymous friend who later turned out to be Horace Rackham would agree to give the city an additional 160 acres of land adjoining the property. And that would turn out to be the Rackham Golf Course and the parking area, which is now currently on the in the service drive area of 696. This project was originally undertaken by renowned zoo designer Carl Hagenbeck, and whose son Heinrich Hagenbeck of Hamburg, Germany, was dispatched to oversee the project of the Detroit Zoo. And the goal was to create a cageless environment for the animals. Very well-respected designers, both Heinrich and Carl Hagenbeck, using moat designs, they placed animals in what looked like their natural habitats. And those started out in the 20s and when the zoo was first founded, and you still see them there today, and for the most part, they're very effective, although the zoo has been very innovative in adding new exhibits like the Arctic Ring of Life and the Apes exhibit and that type of thing. So what you're really looking at is an expansion on that that's developed over need and an education over time as to how much space it really requires to house these animals. And again, this got into the part where discussion, as Chairman Dakaroff has alluded to, as to whether or not the city has the wherewithal to decide what's best for the animals and what's not. And we kind of listen to what the zoo has to say with what's respect to the animals as to what they need to go forward with that. So hence the expansion was submitted for a permit to the city of Huntington Woods. When you take a look at it, what the history of the exhibit is, in that and a lot of the double reinforced concrete projects that you see in the zoo, whether it was there, the lion exhibit that was donated originally by Walter Briggs, and that were part of the some of the WPA projects. So if you take a look at that, you'll be able to see that there's a vast history with the zoo. The zoo kind of grew up along with the times, and if you take a look at it, every part of the zoo has a place in history and a place in time, which is kind of interesting. Other than that, I really don't have anything to offer as far as the construction techniques. I will tell you that the plans have been reviewed by our building official and found to be sufficient. Our plumbing and mechanical inspector has reviewed them and found them to be completely sufficient. And I have nothing else to add unless you have any questions that I might be able to take a shot at.
Thank you. Any members of the public wishing to comment on this particular application, please speak up. Okay, we'll close public participation. I'm going to start with the mayor. And sir, do you have any comments? And also, well, you know what? Why don't we just deal with the site plan application, then we'll talk about the other issue afterward. Any comments?
I have no issues with the plan at all. I will add that from my understanding, the zoo's contractor did come into the city back prior to this project starting
and did get their permits at that time, and it was in error, the city's error, that they were issued. So as far as the zoo knew, they were fully compliant with what we had asked them to do.
Which is our understanding as well. Thank you.
Yep.
Sheldon?
Well, drawn on my extensive background in raising giraffes. I certainly have no comment, but thank you, Mayor, for answering that question, which came to my mind, which is how did the permits get issued in the first place? Other than that, I'm not about to second-guess anything as long as the appropriate city people have looked at the various portions of the thing and decide it's okay from an engineering and all of the other codes, I'm satisfied.
No issues.
Well, I would like to say that at the men's club auction this weekend, I purchased the zoo basket, and I am now in the custody of a stuffed giraffe, which I plan to give a very nice home to, and I think it has plenty of room inside my house, and a very nice book on the history of the zoo, which I am currently reading. So, but other than that, which is the full extent of my experience with giraffes, I am just fine with what's going on.
Martha?
I have no issues with it. I'm glad they're going to get some more space.
Yeah.
No issues.
No issues.
And neither do I. So why don't we take a vote if anyone wants to make a motion?
I move to approve as presented.
I second it.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed. Okay, before we move on to the next, thank you very much. You may wish to stick around in case there's any further discussion. I would like, I guess, if you want your plans back, which are very voluminous, to
that's
ask
approximately a third of the plans that were submitted for this.
The panel to comment if any.
That was a Morgan Heller one you just threw up there. I don't think you want that.
Oh, did that's you're a Morgan Heller?
Yeah. You're going to want to give him that.
Oh, five. Sorry. I number them. Thank you. So, just because we are kind of in a way going over old ground, I thought it might be good if we were to comment after having been through this on whether we collectively or individually have any particular feelings about the wisdom of this body reviewing these types of site plans. As a by way of background, we did go over this issue before, and we made a determination that we're only going to exercise our jurisdiction over these site plan applications to the extent they reasonably could be considered as in any way impacting our neighbors, particularly on Huntington Road. And nevertheless, the City Commission apparently rejected that consensus. For reasons of which I am not quite clear. So I'd like to start with the mayor and ask whether you have any opinion on this. Can you give us some background? Because I don't want to, I want to make sure that no resources are being wasted and that the employees of the city's time is being used efficiently. And if there is a consensus, I don't think there's anything wrong with our reiterating it. And if there's not, there's not. But I think today's site plan application at least warrants this revisitation of the issue that we previously dealt with.
I can address the concern you're having.
Okay.
When your recommendation came to City Council, there were a couple commissioners that had an issue with basically issuing a blanket okay to the zoo. They wanted somebody, being the planning commission, to look over, even if it is a very brief review of anything that's going on, to make sure that it didn't have an impact on the community. They didn't feel that it was right to just give them carte blanche. The rest of the commission went along with the views of those two commissioners and voted to keep it the way it was, where they had to come to the planning commission with any future building projects.
Do you have any opinion one way or the other that you'd like to express or not? Just because I'm trying to figure out, in light of where we are, whether we should restate a concern.
You would be arguing up the wrong tree because I was in the planning commission's corner on this one.
Okay.
I didn't think it was necessary.
Okay. Sheldon, any comments at all that you'd like to make?
This is going to be somewhat Solomonic. I see nothing wrong, depending on who else does it or who else might have jurisdiction over it. This isn't involved with the distrust of the zoo or of any more than it's involved with the distrust of any other builder, contractor, or architect that comes before us. But I would have no problem, and I'm reassured that the city did go over it in terms of the plumbing and the electrical and whatever structural issues might be involved from that standpoint. I'm not about to tell the zoo or second guess their judgment as to how tall, how big, how wide, or anything like that in terms of the configuration or the appearance of the whatever may need to be, whatever they may want to build. But depending on who else has a piece of those things, what other governmental entity has a piece of those engineering issues, I'll just sort of lump them in that direction. I would rather that were done than it was just oops and something went wrong later.
Okay, thank you.
I don't have anything else to add. Okay. I agree with Sheldon.
Hank, I think that I would be right in saying that whether or not we review the site plan or not, the city will, in issuing the permits, verify that the appropriate electrical, plumbing, and all of those codes are being met with the design that's being put forth.
That's correct. When, for example, the zoo submits the plans that you got were just the readable portions or the mm-hmm. portions that made sense to give the planning commission. They didn't show like all the electrical details. They didn't show every plumbing detail, where every gate valve was, where every switch box was, or anything like that. When something comes in for review, and it's an engineered drawing, it's required to go through the building official. The building official then decides whether or not it's required to go through an engineering review, and if that's the case, then he'll send it to the city engineer. If he feels comfortable with his review of it, then he'll review it. It also has to pass a mechanical inspection, and mechanicals would include gas lines, HVAC, any type of ventilation for that particular exhibit. Also plumbing, also electrical. So it's reviewed by, and in Huntington Woods we have two inspectors. One does the mechanical and plumbing, both of them, and is licensed and certified for both. The other is a licensed building official, an Act 54 building inspector, as well as an electrical inspector. So before the permits get issued, this receives a very thorough review of the construction aspect of it. And I think where Chairman Dockroff was going I think to answer your question is that yes, it absolutely receives a very thorough structural and code review as far as that goes. And I think if what I'm reading is correct is that, what the question becomes is that at that point in time, has we done our responsibility provided that this building is not within a certain parameter of the city of Huntington Woods streets or residences proper, and did they want to revisit that? I think that's where, or at least that's what I was getting from what.
Okay.
He was saying.
Thank you, Martha.
I think the only.
Were you finished?
Yeah, I mean,
sorry.
My point was simply that the stuff that we're look that that we would look at is as pertains to the zoo is going to be is if it causes any grief to the people who live along Huntington Road, but that we should feel assured that if something doesn't come in front of us and it's in the interior of the zoo where it doesn't affect the people living on Huntington Road, that all of the mechanical and electrical and plumbing and all of those aspects are being looked at by the city, whether or not it comes forward to us.
That's absolutely correct.
So that
correct.
Was the only point I was trying to make.
Okay, Martha?
I agree with Jill that I think if I remember correctly, that's what we were most concerned with,
right.
mm-hmm. is people on Huntington. So I guess the only thing that I am concerned about, because I would never try to tell the zoo what to do with animal enclosures and things that are directly related to the animals, but that's not the only kind of building that can be done there. You know, building of bathrooms and commissary and things like that, which have occurred on Huntington Road, are maybe some concerns and having...
Well, remember what we did the last time
right.
was within, I think, a bandwidth of, was it 300 feet or 150?
25 feet.
No, no,
no,
no, no, no, no.
It was
how much, how long was it?
If I remember right, was it 200 feet?
Yeah, but I think it was from the center line of the road.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And any new construction that was not animal habitat related, regardless of where it was in the zoo, needed site plan. So if it was a biodigester or...
So that's still enforced? Because
yeah.
you said that the commission decided to not go with what we had voted
on. The commission said we have to review everything.
Yeah.
It expanded.
Right.
That's all.
Okay.
So
from that standpoint, it is good that we're reviewing at least those things.
It, but that was always
that was
the
always,
plan.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Eric, anything? I mean, sorry. David.
We look a little
bit. Sorry. Yes, I think, didn't he sit in that seat? Maybe not. But
yeah, I remember when we sat here and went over the Huntington Road and those five or six exhibits, and I was a little surprised to see this in the packet, and
yeah.
certainly I was okay with the plan we had presented, but...
Okay. Aaron?
So, I'm a neighbor of the camels, actually. I spoke up as a public participant at the time we had this discussion. I felt that the commission acting as a review board, even in a rather perfunctory nature as in today's case, was not overly burdensome and didn't need to be given away as a responsibility. I still, in general, feel that way, although the compromise you reached at the time was not unreasonable. I will, however, point out it's been nearly 2 years or more since that compromise was
Has
reached.
Has it been that long?
Well, I wasn't on the commission when it was
yeah.
reached. So I think it's nearly been 2 years, and this has been the only thing that has come up in that time.
Okay, and that's certainly a legitimate observation. I do think it's unnecessary. I'm not going to ask for a vote on this. I think that I have not heard, frankly, an explanation that is satisfying to me as to why the commission, the Planning Commission's recommendation and vote was rejected. I'm not going to second guess the judgment of the City Commission, but I do think that the exercise that we went through today, our, you know, admitted lack of expertise over what we're being asked to approve, the fact that, yes, it occurs only once every so often, but the need to submit these site plans does constitute, I would argue, a burden on our city employees whose resources and times are limited, that I would hope that the City Commission would take it upon itself to consider reconsidering the wisdom of that repudiation, I guess is the word, of our recommendation. And I don't say that in any pejorative or confrontational way. It's just something that I think today's experience underscores that maybe it might not be harmful to revisit this issue. But again, if it's not, it's not the end. If they don't, it's not the end of the world. I just want the record to establish that I think you know, we spoke not necessarily as a single body, but this will be, I guess, televised, and the City Commission can see what we said. I think we can move on, unless anyone else has got anything to add to this one. Okay, we'll move on. The next matter is the addition to 26028 Huntington.
My wife Kathy could not be here tonight. She wanted to, but our 4-year-old son Danny, another rabbit, so she's with him tonight. We've lived in Berkeley since 2006. We picked this area for a lot of reasons, not the least of which is its proximity to Huntington, was our ultimate objective in terms of what we wanted to call home. And we're able to accomplish that in 2014. We love mid-century modern design, and we're fortunate to find a beautiful property on the corner of Huntington and Lincoln, but a property needs a lot of work. And we put in significant amount of work to bring it up to the code in a number of areas, make it a livable, desirable place to call home long term. And we did so. We put significant work into it. We brought it back to life. We've become, obviously, as a result of that and other reasons, including interpersonal, to have a lot of commitment to Huntington Woods as our home and the place where we went through as a family. But in this process, since we moved in to where we've been now, we've had significant changes in our family relative to illness, aging, mobility. So what was a love for architecture and having a ranch mid-century home is turning out to be a blessing because of the fact that we may eventually, before too long here, have relatives that will come to move with us and having a home that we then have the right layout for us to be able to live and live policing as a family. As with the remodel that we did in 2000, we started the remodel in 2013 and completed in 2014.
Yeah.
We've really sought to keep the style of architecture. So mid-century house, ranch, brick, exterior fascia, really keeping within the style of the home. And in the process of this remodel, we thought it would be appropriate to address a significant safety concern that we have with the location of the property, the driveway, safety concerns for my family, for our neighbors that surround the property, and even for motorists on Lincoln. And that's the reason why we're here. We want to share with you that which we aim to do. We seek to share with you our intent with the remodel and to seek your perspective and certain approval in that which we're looking to do. As a closing comment before I pass over to Ben to speak to the technical merits, of which I'm going to be over my skis here very quickly, is to just comment that I've been, I don't know if it's blessed or cursed, to have lived in a lot of different communities. I've lived in many cities, I've lived in over 6 countries. And what I've learned in the time of being in so many places is that great communities are well run, and they're so because, you know, oftentimes you look after each other. And as a commission, having sat in some of them in other places, I've always felt that the people who are good at running the community, they look after what is right for the community. So not just doing the right, but doing things right to make sure that you adhere to code and commit to that which is the plan for the city. So not just doing doing things right, but doing the right thing. And so we're grateful that you'd be open to listening to us and what we're looking to accomplish. And thank you for your time. So with that, Ben.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Ben?
Thank you, Ben Heller. You guys obviously know me. I'll explain the project a little bit more. I know you guys have had a chance to review the plans a bit. Just to help clarify, the project meets the total square footage limitation. It meets the total lot coverage, or we're within the total lot coverage. The house happens to be a pre-existing non-conforming unit. I've been before you, it seems like this year, several times with corner lots in Huntington Woods that are abnormal compared to any of the other lots in the city. They have these really strange features where, you know, one side, it could be the front, is really the side, and there really is no back. And so this is really one of those kind of lots where to even do anything to the house, the whole house sits completely pre-existing non-conforming. With that said, there's 2 additions we're adding onto the house as you're studying the plans. One addition is for a master suite, which is really to the corner. And that addition does meet, when we do the calculations of the side yard, and we will be going to ZBA because of the pre-existing non-conforming, but that addition does meet, we purposely designed it to meet the side yard, so that even though we're going to be asking for a variance for pre-existing non-conforming, we're not going to be asking for an additional variance for, like, encroaching into the side yard. So we try to really respect that. And I mean, obviously, we respected the architecture. The Georges bought the house because they appreciated the mid-century style. It's been, a lot of the projects I've done lately seem to be like old Tudors that we've made to look like old Tudors. And so this has been exciting to kind of do something a little more modern and but really keep it in line and not, you know, the within the rules, we could build a much bigger house on this site. We could build a second story, another 1,000 or so square feet. That's not the intention here. The intention is completely to build a ranch and to keep the house, to keep the feeling that it was, that the house always was. So that's the one aspect that we're building on one side. And then the other part of the addition that we're building is for the garage. And Mr. George, he slightly commented on the safety part. And that's really what we're trying to do is right now, the only way they can get out from their garage, they literally have to back out into the main street. So what we did is we brought the garage and turned it, and we created an area where they could back out and then pull out head first into the street. So that was a really important criteria of the project. And so that's what we had designed there. And then in fact, the original design that we did complete finished drawings, was several feet closer to the rear yard. And after consulting with Hank and trying to really come up with the minimal that would meet the need, we pulled it back, and so you can see it, the way the addition's drawn, that we're quite a bit from the rear yard. Is it really a rear yard? You know, the way it's the other home's side yards that is our rear yard in that back corner. So we really are staying further from our neighbors from that spot, and so we really try to be sensitive to that. And really with that, I turn it over for any questions, and just wanted to kind of give you guys a feeling for what we're doing with the project there.
Thanks. Hank?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Basically, a couple things for what they're doing with this house is the house is sat on one of the more irregular lots in the city of Huntington Woods. The house also sits in an irregular configuration on the lot in Huntington Woods. And as a result of that, they're left with very little space that they can do or additions that they can make and still respect the original architecture of the house, which is typical of what Mr. Heller usually brings before us. What we have here is a situation where the garage addition and some of that area that you see back there has been a problem over the course of the years. If you take a look at where the house sits on the lot, the crest of that hill, which is the Lincoln Hill, which you all pretty much drive over every day one way or another, is blind. And as a result, by the configuration of angling the garage with the T, which is a turnaround T, allowing the front egress out of the property onto Lincoln, makes all the sense in the world. I did go ahead and I did place a note on your packet, and I'll just read it. The addition of the garage emplacement facilitate a front exit from the site. The angle of the garage and placement of the turning T allows egress in a much safer manner. It does, however, require a rear yard variance. I discussed the situation with public safety, and they agreed that it is a much better layout to access Lincoln. They said there have been many near misses reported as it is on the downside of the slope of Lincoln Hill going west. Public safety supports the design for those reasons. And I did talk to Lieutenant Zawacki over that, and we had a pretty good conversation about it. And to him, it made sense in order to do that as it facilitates a much safer ingress and egress from the property. The rest of the addition in and of itself is characteristic of respecting the architecture of the original house. When you take a look at it, let me just pull this back here real quick. They're under the maximum house size. They're under the lot coverage. The rear yard proposed setback is now 29 feet. And what I did want to point out is that originally it was going to be 24 feet to the rear yard setback. But Mr. Heller has brought the garage in a little bit more in order to make it less of a variance that would be required to that, yet still facilitate the project, which we appreciated. If you take a look at the height of it, it's still only 15 feet high, so they're completely respecting that, even though the height of the zoning district could be up to 35 feet. The lot in and of itself is 18,674 square feet. The neighbor to the north is 12,800, which is still a substantial lot, but this lot actually adds approximately 6,000 square feet more than that in its irregular configuration if you take a look at it. It is a one-story house, and it does have an attached garage as proposed by Mr. Heller. It meets the standards and the guidelines for that. The only thing, again, as we pointed out, is that we do need to ask for variance as a result of the configuration. But other than that, it meets the criteria for the standards and guidelines for the construction of an addition for that zone district. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them, as I'm sure Mr. Heller can. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I would turn it back to you.
Thank you. Would any member of the public like to comment on this particular site plan application? Okay. I will note that we were presented with two letters in our packet supporting it from neighbors. And I'll ask Aaron for any comments. And is there a third one? Oh, yeah. Is Trey here tonight?
Yeah. That was received by email, so after the agenda went out, so I put a copy of that particular neighbor's recommendation.
And just make one comment, those are the direct neighbors directly adjoining the property that we reviewed, just so everyone is aware of that. Thank you.
Cool. Aaron?
Yeah, Hank, a couple of questions you could help clarify. So I get the what is referred to as the rear yard.
Yes, sir.
Right? If that was a side lot, that would be 15 feet?
Yeah.
All right. And then what is the second variance? Is it for the existing wall on the north side of the lot?
No, the actual, well, yes, because the existing wall, the way that the code reads, is that you can't go, you can go straight up, straight back, which is what this would be, because the front of this property is technically on Huntington. But you can't exacerbate the condition by going any closer. So what happens is that at the front of the house, there's a 4.9 width to the side lot line. At the rear of the house, there's a 4.4 width. As you pull that back, the additional 5 feet, the space will get wider, but it will still be less. So there still will be technically some construction in the side yard. So what I did was is I wanted to point that out so that if I do talk to the city attorney and it does require the second variance, that you will have at least had a chance knowing that that may be the situation.
So just for the clarification of our notes, the two variances that could be needed are what and what?
Definitely there's one variance, and the one variance would need to be for the rear yard. Mm-hmm. The other might be because the actual structure sits in an irregular configuration on the property, causing it to slant towards the sideline.
So we'll call it the rear yard variance and the side variance.
Yes.
And the house and side yard are not parallel.
Yes. And in both cases, these are brought on by the irregular configuration of the lot and the house, which would be up to the Zoning Board of Appeals to decide whether or not they would support that.
Gotcha.
Yes, sir.
Maybe this is just for my personal edification, since I have an irregular lot, but not as regular.
Yes, you do.
My understanding of the setback that would be required against Lincoln is driven by the front yard setback of the house further up Lincoln.
It would be, except for this house is particular, the way that this situates, the house is already there. So the lot width on this, if you take a look at it, nothing is the same on this. So are you asking if the setback has to be the same on this house for that the front of the house is on next door to it because that fronts Lincoln? Is that what you
My understanding of the zoning ordinance would be that the house that would be east on Lincoln, its front setback would drive the setback of the George's house facing Lincoln.
Technically, and again, that was something that I was going to go over with the city attorney, because the way that the front of that house is would be equal to about almost a third of the way through this house as it exists right now.
I don't dispute that fact.
If in fact that turns out to be the case, then when it goes to the Zoning Board of Appeals, it'll go that way.
Okay, and I'm not saying that affects my opinion.
Right.
I'm just trying to make sure I understand.
Yes, sir.
Okay, the only substantive comment I had was that I was concerned a little bit about the fenestration on the garage as it faces the neighbor on Lincoln. That visual walk and seems like it borders on
any grade. Otherwise, it's a gorgeous house. I'm happy to see you adding to the neighborhood and appreciate your investment.
You're talking about on the right side elevation?
I'm talking about the east, or what would be termed the rear elevation.
What would you term the rear? As I went through these plans the other day, it was without break.
But in these plans, it's called the right side elevation. Yeah.
Well, it.
He's talking about this.
Can't find it today.
Well, that's okay. Mr. Heller actually has it up.
It's on the last page.
Yeah.
Ben, if you could address that for them.
Yeah. So it's almost easier to just look. I'm almost on the floor plan. Is that we're talking about this angle of the wall that's facing the back? That it's a solid. A solid garage wall.
Yes. Am I seeing that correctly?
Yes. Yeah, we're showing that as a full brick wall. It's not. It is. That wall is
25.
It's 25 feet long. It's the length of a garage. Contemporary wall. I mean, we certainly could add a high window in there. It does face into like this kind of odd corner where you're just looking into. You got three garages kind of coming together into one corner. So our thinking was, you know, keep it clean.
It's the back of the garage, is it not?
Yeah,
like the rear wall of the garage.
It is.
No.
It's the rear yard
it's
wall.
Side. Yeah. Okay.
It is actually actually the side wall of the garage.
It is
welcome
the side wall
of the garage.
Yeah. It would be parallel to the side of the car.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Perpendicular.
Passenger side garage.
Yes.
Yeah. And perpendicular to the street where you'd be walking
on
the sidewalk.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's it for me. Thank you very much.
I have no comments on this one.
I'm familiar with the area. I walk around there all the time with my dog. I think you've done a nice job, not only updating the house, but also with this latest addition. I think it'll be fine. And I applaud you for trying to find a safer way to get in and out of your driveway. I know that's it's like a and for pedestrians as well. I'm always like, well, is it safe? Run, you know, because you never know who's coming in or going out. So, bravo! I'm very pleased with it.
Oh, thank you.
I second Aaron's thing across the back. It doesn't bother me that much. That side of the garage doesn't bother me too much because I agree with you. They are a bunch of garages facing each other. I again also applaud you for keeping the style of the house. I love the fact that you are maintaining it as a ranch.
Mm-hmm.
You're not trying to go up. You're not taking in a mid-century modern and trying to turn it into something it's not. And I like it.
Thank you. As another mid-century house owner in the woods, thank you for preserving the very few pieces of mid-century architecture we have left. Same thing. Thank you for not putting a hat on this thing. I love it. It's great. Don't change the thing.
Thank you.
Shall we?
I had absolutely no criticism. I have a technical question. Hank?
Yes, sir.
Does a driveway comply with applicable ordinances in terms of width and that sort of stuff?
Yes.
Isn't there something that says that the drive can't be roughly any wider than the garage or the garage door?
The garage width. The apron that you can have to turn is not actually part of the driveway proper, so what they look at is the width of the door going forward. And if you take a look at the width of the door going forward, it doesn't, the opening as it sits right now is off center no matter what you do. So, and it's smaller no matter what you do. They could actually make that bigger up to 22 feet. But what they've done is they've just taken that and made an area that they can come out and drive forward in. So as far as that goes, the garage is 22.5 feet wide, and it looks like it's just set right to the corner of that, or the one corner might be in just a little bit. That's something that we could work out when building permit, when we get
okay.
a permit.
Just asking.
Yeah, no, I appreciate the thought.
I have no concerns or criticisms, but obviously the understanding that if this plan gets approved, we do not have any control over the zoning board. They'll make their own decision.
Mayor?
I have no issues with the plan as presented. I like everything you're doing.
Very good, thanks.
I feel the same way, and I'm normally, you know, very concerned about fenestration, but I think your explanation is adequate, and this is a well-fenestrated home. Of course.
Sure, of course.
Trey Bryce is your neighbor to the east?
Across the street.
Diagonal.
Okay,
diagonal.
Has there been any contact with the neighbor just east of you on Lincoln?
Yes.
Okay.
Because I didn't. I mean, is one of those letters from them?
No. So the two letters that we have, one is from the Egnotovich Lane family, which lives, if you're standing to facing the property, it would be north, so to the left of the house on Huntington. And then the Furmans, who are on Lincoln, on the adjacent side to the driveway. So they would also be heavily impacted because they would have to look at it every day. And so they review the plans, yeah.
Okay, thank you for your indulgence.
Okay, I think we're ready for a motion. Would anyone like to make a motion?
I move to approve as presented.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Do we need a...
Oh, right, you want to put on your motion, there's two variances.
Subject to the zoning board of appeals.
Subject to the zoning, approval by the zoning board of appeals.
And just, everyone knows that we're definitely going to have a rear yard variance, and we may have to have a side variance. So your motion will incorporate that. There was a second to that, is that okay, as amended? Any discussion, guys? Okay, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your good work, and we're excited. I live down the road from you on Huntington, a block or so north, so looking forward to it.
Likewise.
How long have you lived here?
We moved in December of 14.
Okay.
In the first year we moved in, we did a holiday party.
Uh-huh.
And we had neighbors that came out, so we lived here for 20 years.
Okay, I did not.
We've never met other neighbors in this one property.
Yeah. So
we'll extend it to your...
Yeah, we're at 26413. We got a great block.
Yeah.
So what foreign countries have you lived in and why?
So I'm Brazilian by birth.
Okay.
So I started my career in Brazil. Moved to the U.S. From the U.S. lived in Mexico. Mexico, went to Spain to India.
What do you do, if I can ask?
I help companies expand abroad and to bring manufacturing.
Well, you're very...
So, there you go.
Well, nice meeting you.
Likewise.
We expect to be invited to your party next time. Okay. The next item on the agenda is the addition on Wareham 25524.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Mayor, and the school board. How are you?
Hello.
Hello. My name is Brian Lee. I am with Metro Home Improvements. I represent Steve and Karen Seporin, who are proposing to build the addition on Wareham currently. I have submitted a revised plot as well as a plan. Reasoning for the addition, obviously I'm sure you probably hear a lot of these, but Mr. Support is an esteemed member of the community. He is an attorney who resides and works in Huntington Woods. He has taken his father, who is gravely ill, and he will be bringing him into his home. He can no longer care for himself. They had tried to put him into an assisted living facility, and they could not work with him within the assisted living facility. I got involved in this project back in June of 2016. Previously, Mr. and Mrs. Seporin had come before the board and were trying to build an addition strictly for usage of making the space larger and more comfortable for themselves. I believe that they had went through the process and gotten all the way down to the end of it, and there were some questions. The current architect at the time had done some things to the plan, I guess, that they weren't approved for. If you look at the plan, you'll see that a lot of this has changed dramatically. We have actually, this is my fourth set of plans since June, to try to shrink this down and get it as close as we possibly can to conform within the city's zoning laws. We are creating barrier-free areas, so when the father moves in, he won't be restricted. As you can see, there would be an elevator installed in the home, so he can get from floor to floor. Currently, it's a two-story home. It's very small and compartmentalized. therefore he would not be able to maneuver through the home if we don't create some barrier-free space or area for him in the home. The survey that was on record was improper. I had to go get a new survey for you guys so that I could get it sealed. The one that I had currently, and I believe that was submitted before, was improper and didn't have the proper dimensions or measurements on it. So I had the new survey done and stamped as well. I believe we're very close on the coverage with the conformity. The exterior of the home, I know there's some conformity issues there with the construction. We have researched the materials as far as the brick. If you'll notice, there's an offset on the addition. And the reason the offset is there is because the brick is no longer made. We can't find it anywhere. So we had stepped it back and offset it so you wouldn't be able to see from the street that it wasn't brick all the way through. He's on I guess it would be an atypical to Huntington Woods lot, but it's a very small lot. As far as conformity goes, we've kind of put building materials on this that we believe would conform with what's being built currently or being renovated in the city with the hardy siding and stripping the brick off the back wall and using it as a ledge all the way around the perimeter. So we can tie that element back into the house and not make this look like it's been added on at all. So I come before you tonight with that in mind and to see if we would get through the planning. And then we're also going to have to apply for a variance because I believe we're slightly over on our square footage size with respect to the lot coverage.
Thank you. Hank.
Thank you. Basically, there's a couple things with this that I just wanted to point out. The survey that Mr. Lee alludes to is the one that you had at your places this evening. And that I did not get until after the agendas were already delivered to you on Friday. So we could take a look. I'd be happy to address any concerns that you have with that. But he is under the lot coverage. The lot in and of itself is 7,500 square feet. In an R1C lot, typical R1C lots are 7,000 and up, so it is consistent with the lot size for the area. What we're looking at here is an addition off the rear, and we're looking at a partial brick, which I assume that Mr. Lee intends to reclaim the brick that comes off the back of the house, and that's why he's going around with the half brick wall going up, and then he'll pick it up with siding as is shown on the plan. The house height is maximum of 2 stories, 30 feet. It's proposed at 23 feet. The front yard meets the requirements. The side yards, minimum of 4.4 on one side and 15.4 on the other, which was at that plan. Actually, with the revised survey, it goes down to 4.3. So when we go to the Zoning Board of Appeals, he will also need a side yard variance for that, because he's coming closer to the side yard. So, and I was just able to look at that for a few minutes today. So he's going to the Zoning Board of Appeals anyway. One is for over the maximum house size for this. Again, his lot coverage now with this survey is at 29.31, which would meet the house size. And he's looking at a house that is 3,412.5 total square feet. That includes taking out the elevator on one floor and the stairs on one floor as I have it. So the maximum that he can have is 3,300 square feet, so he'll be asking for a variance of approximately 112.5 square feet. Having said that, except for the materials codicil, he has fenestration on all sides, and he is working on this in a barrier-free mode. I would point out that the houses do not have to comply with ADA, but in the Fair Housing Act, once you get into it, if there's no other way, and this goes for the Zoning Board of Appeals, not necessarily for the Planning Commission, as I understand the Fair Housing Act, if the only way to allow for a handicapped person to have the house is to give him the additional space, then the ZBA, according to the Fair Housing Act, would be inclined to do so. But having said that, they would have to demonstrate that there's no other way to accommodate this within the confines of the original house or within the confines meeting the code. So having said that, I really have nothing else. If you have any questions, I'm sure Mr. Lee or myself would be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Thanks, Hank. Public participation on this one. Okay, public participation will close. I'll start with the mayor.
My first question would be to the matching of the brick. It is not possible. I understand the exact brick isn't being made, but it's not possible to get a matching brick.
We've searched numerous suppliers, and there's nothing that would even come close to it. So our idea is to reclaim all the brick off the rear of the home and then reuse that as a belt all the way around the new structure so we can tie it in somewhat and conform with the neighborhood and the integrity of the house.
I think I would rather see more brick used on the side of the house in order to
do away with it or use a brick that doesn't quite match perfectly on the rear of the building. I think that's all I have at this point.
Okay, Sheldon.
Within the guidelines that we have here, I'm generally satisfied with the design of the house. Willing to listen to other comments from the commission, but and I know that we have, without necessarily specifically identifying quantity or something like that, we have approved plans that have similarly used brick that's been reclaimed off of other portions of the house and accepted these kinds of accommodations that includes using that to partially cover the new construction up to a number of courses of brick around the house. And I know we've done that in the past. Whether or not it's appropriate here, but I do know that we have done that in the past. What is, the addition also incorporates siding. What is it? Is it hardy board?
It is. Yeah, it would be James Hardy, and it would be pre-finished, factory pre-finished. So it would conform with the color scheme on the home currently.
Okay.
And we have researched, drove around the city, and we've researched some of the new builds that are going on and some of the remodels. So as far as the Hardy product goes, it would fit in as a proper building element as to what is being constructed currently in the city.
That's all my questions.
I guess Hardy was one of my questions. No plans to paint the brick. You're gonna leave the brick natural.
No, what we would do is we would reclaim the brick. We'd clean it really well. We'd acid wash it, and then we would reuse the brick and put a limestone cap on it, which would marry with what's existing currently.
I actually appreciate that effort. I've seen the same thing done several times throughout the city. I actually prefer that rather than mismatched brick. I've seen brick that's close but not quite, and I think it looks worse.
Yeah, we felt the same. We felt the same way.
Yeah, I think you guys did a good job on fenestration. I've got no issues. I think it's a good thing you're doing.
What year was the house built? The original?
I currently don't have that information for you.
Wait, do we know?
I'm going to guess that it was built in the 50s, as were most of the houses on that particular block.
And
40s and 50s.
In the 50s, and you haven't been able to find brick?
No, the particular brick that's on there is an oversized brick, and the color is the problem, the color match.
Right.
So it was a specialty brick that they used on the home to give it the look that it currently has. And we've searched Belden, we've been to Colonial, we've been to numerous brickyards, and they've all told us the same thing, that the brick is no longer in existence.
And you haven't found any other reclaimed places that could have it?
No.
Have you searched reclaimed places?
Every place I've went to, I've asked that same question. I've asked, are there any reclaimed yards that would have it? And they just said, no, it wasn't I don't think it was a highly popular brick. It's not like it was a red fired brick or something that would be in that genre.
Okay. My next question is the windows on the second floor of the addition are quite a bit smaller than the windows used everywhere else. and they just look a little out of proportion. Your windows on your first floor.
Are you talking about the ones on the side, ma'am, or the ones in the rear?
I'm talking about the north elevation and the south elevation.
Okay.
On the second floor.
All right.
They're 24 by 48.
Those could be increased. That's not an issue. I mean, that those could definitely be increased.
I just think that it would be a little bit more appealing if they were not smaller than the rest of them. So you've got 36 by 48 on the first floor. You've got 40 by 56 on the top floor in the back because of your egress windows. I just would want to see them.
I do believe the reason that he did that was because there's not a lot of wall space, being that this addition would be 17 feet, 4.5 inches out. So by doing that, he wanted to create wall space for obviously abandoned furniture. Increasing those by 12 inches is not the end of the world. That's something that we could make a change and that'd be readily done.
Okay. I guess I would prefer to see those windows become a little bit bigger. You said you stepped it in. You stepped the addition in to minimize the look of the siding.
Yeah.
On one side, you did it on the other.
Absolutely. We did it on the one side. And on the other side, if you look where the exterior is, I've got basically a 4-inch step there lining up on the wall.
Yeah. Four inches is enough.
It's not huge, no.
4 inches doesn't change the visual of it. The 3 feet changes the visual of it. So my concerns are the side with the master. You stepped in one side, the other side is just this long straight wall where you go from brick to hardy board. And my other concern is I would like to see those windows made bigger on the second floor on both the north elevation and south elevation.
And that's something that can be easily rectified.
From the back, you've got great fenestration on the back. That's great. I do appreciate that if you can't find the brick, I do appreciate that you are pulling the brick off the back and that you are reusing it to make the skirt. And the skirt is about how tall?
Approximately 3 feet, 6 inches to 4 feet, depending on what I have with brick after we install the brick ledge.
Okay. I think that's all I have right now.
Martha?
I guess I would agree with Joe what she was saying. I too agree that the windows are way too small. And I also agree that you should consider a setback on the other side so you don't have this long running wall, especially where you're jumping from brick to siding so quickly. So that brick is that color? It's not painted?
I went past it
yesterday and it was a little dull out, and I thought it was painted.
No, it's actually that color.
No wonder you're having trouble finding it.
it's not a very common brick.
Yeah. Okay. That's pretty much all I have to say.
I could have combined the elements of stone there as well on the sides of the home, but I think that if we were to combine the elements of stone, I think we would have created this big masculine, overbearing addition. So that's why we That's why we worked within the James Hardy. Mm-hmm. We researched it and we looked at it in numerous ways because we did have a plan drawn for stone.
I would agree with the comments made about the window sizes and matching those to the, I think the 36 by 48 is what's being said. I appreciate the effort you made to at least look into the brick. I know when we've had concerns in the past, we've ask people to go to brickyards and report back, so appreciate that. I am concerned with exceeding the maximum square footage.
No, it's not me. Mark.
But those are my only comments.
I sound like a broken record. I agree with Joe's comments regarding the windows in the north and south elevation. I appreciate the effort you put into trying to find brick. It's an understandable situation. I am also concerned about the overage. I'm assuming we're going to pass that on to the ZBA.
Maybe.
That's all I have to say.
Hank, thank you.
Yes.
Can you recall a time when we have approved a house, and I certainly recognize the needs of the homeowner, that have exceeded the maximum house size? I do not recall an instance.
Typically, this is kind of an interesting situation in that if the house meets all the criteria, even though one of the standards is not to exceed the maximum house size, you do have the authority as the Planning Commission to pass it subject to the
right.
Zoning Board of Appeals granting and allow the gentleman to make his case to the Zoning Board of Appeals. And that would be based on the fact that there's some practical difficulty or hardship that he can prove that runs with the land, as opposed to, I just want it bigger. So that would be up to him with the Zoning Board of Appeals. And I do want to comment that you should not be considering this project on the merits of the variance or not, because that's the province of the Zoning Board of Appeals, but rather that does the project in and of itself have merit to move it forward, and is it consistent in the spirit of the guidelines and the spirit of the standards that you could feel comfortable moving it forward.
Okay.
I did have one other question for this too, because it's not on the plan. Since the whole project is based and the overage is based on the barrier-free and handicap aspect, I did not see a handicap ramp anywhere proposed for this.
Hence the elevator is where they were planning on using for access.
Got it. How are they getting into the house?
From the exterior, I believe the deck had a handicap ramp that was supposed to be installed on it.
Okay, I'm looking at stairs, but I...
Yeah, he may have left the provision out, but that was the
reason. That will end up being a ramp,
that,
is what you're saying.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I would like to talk a little bit more about exceeding the house size. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to, you know, front my comments by saying I don't think we've ever done it since I've been part of the commission, which is 4.5 years or 5 years or something like that. You know, house size is extraordinarily important in terms of our consideration, and we try and respect them. Those are hard and fast rules. That's one, and you're also on a very small lot, which would make the house size that much more noticeable and impactful. I'm certainly cognizant of the appeals that were in the letter that was attached to our package, but it didn't satisfy me that there's actually a need for it. And I'm not saying there's not a need for it. I'm saying I'm not satisfied. And so I would like to know, if you were to attempt to demonstrate or prove that this is necessary, how would you do that and what would you say?
First and foremost, the impact that we have here, it's not that I'm impacting the lot size where I'm encroaching the lot and making it larger as a first story addition. I'm adding two floors, a bottom and a top.
I understand.
Okay. So that from that aspect, I'm going straight up with I'm going to make my point.
Okay.
I'm going straight up with this. When I started this 10 months ago, mm-hmm. and we've worked with every major scenario that we could possibly work with. It was a lot larger from another architect. They've scaled it back. And that was more of a want than it was a need. It was, hey, let's create this big giant master suite with a big giant walk-in master bathroom, and the downstairs, let's open up the downstairs and have a large entertaining space. Okay? If you look at the way the plan is currently designed with the barrier free, we tried to shrink it back. But what ends up happening is when I shrink this back, it makes this barrier free, the room, barrier free, where the dad is going to stay, it makes it extremely small. So to put a hospital bed, with one that goes up and down, obviously, and any furniture in there, it makes it very, very tight. Then if you get a wheelchair in here, it makes it almost impossible to maneuver around it. So we worked this as tight as we possibly could. Are there a couple of ways we can shave it? Maybe, but we've worked every single scenario that we could. I mean, I've laid this out. This is my fourth set of drawings in 10 months.
Yes, but you've also said that the first set of drawings, at least, was just big without an actual, relationship to the individual's disability. So I don't know whether the second or the third one were like that as well, but let me ask you this question so I'm clear. Who's going to be residing in the house upon its being built?
Mr. Saporin.
Okay.
Mrs. Saporin and Mr. Saporin's ill father.
Okay.
And
they
what?
They have sold his home.
What condition does that individual suffer from?
I couldn't tell you currently. I can get a doctor's.
It's actually in the letter.
Okay,
the
what
letter.
Is it?
It's
yeah,
the
there
letter.
Was it was
heart.
Provided.
It's congenital
okay.
heart failure
okay.
and onset of dementia.
Is he living there now?
Currently, no. He's in assisted living currently right now, but the assisted living where he's at is running Mr. and Mrs. Support on approximately $8,000 per month, and they're not
that's
catering to his needs the way that they would right. be catering to his needs.
Look, I don't want to come across as callous or anything like that, but you know, house size is a really, really important thing that we pay attention to, and I have not heard something that satisfies me that by, to use your word, shaving it 112 square feet, it would materially interfere with the suitability for the father. I haven't heard that proof. And I'm concerned that we're establishing a precedent that could be easily ignored in the future if we were to allow this without at least a larger quantum of proof. You know, and I'm not in any way disrespecting your representations, sir, at all. I'm just thinking, like, unfortunately, the lawyer that I am, that I need more to justify what I think is not a, just an anomalous, you know, thing that we would be doing, but something that hasn't happened before, that to my recollection. I'm also concerned that we're doing that at the same time as the 360 rule is violated. And I understand the whole issue about the brick. I've heard it, and I do see the unique color of the brick. But you add to the 360 violation, the over house size, it's just something that's causing me great discomfort when I'm thinking about precedential impact of our decision making, and it is on a small lot, and you know obviously the windows are a concern, but those have been addressed.
That's a very easily fixed item.
Yeah, of course. So those are my concerns. I'm grappling with them. I'm very sensitive to the needs of the father, but you know we do not make decisions based on, no matter how weird and mean and callous that sounds, on you know. Those type of considerations, and I might be willing to consider it if there were more proof, but it hasn't been presented. Jill?
I have one more question. When we've talked about the overage of the house size, and you focus very solely on the barrier-free section, might I point out that one of the concerns that I brought up and a number of other people did are this long wall where I asked you about the step-in on this side and that there is no step-in on this side. Whenever you talk about reducing the size of the house or taking something out, you're focusing and talking to us about how we are impacting the barrier-free area. It does not have to impact the barrier-free area. The reduction of the house size could impact the master bedroom. It could impact bringing that step in to alleviate the mass of that long wall. There are other ways to do it that do not affect the barrier-free area.
But that just came up tonight when you brought that up.
I understand.
So
I'm simply making the point of that you brought something forward to us, as Andy has said, that is over the maximum house size allowed for the size of this lot that you have, and that when we speak about reducing that massing and that wall, you're very focused on the barrier-free area. Perhaps focus on other areas that don't affect the barrier-free. That's all I'm suggesting.
But again, aesthetically, when I go to tie the home in,
mm-hmm.
and I tie the roof in from the back side of it, it will look out of place because I'm following the long wall up and I'm tying the roof in. So now, possibly, the tie-in is going to look a little funny on the back side. And with respect to what you said, I have no issue stepping it back. If I stepped it in 1 foot,
mm-hmm.
just 1 foot, that would take that long wall out of play.
Mm-hmm.
I would lose 17 feet.
I'm not making that calculation.
I'm sorry? Yeah, yes.
I understand that. I am simply saying that you are over the house, the maximum house size,
yeah,
as Andy pointed out, and you might need to be creative in a way that doesn't affect your barrier-free area and the ability of the father to move within the home. You might need to be a little bit more creative in figuring out how to take that overage out, and at the same time, potentially alleviate that incredibly long wall.
And if you were to step it in to match the other side,
mm-hmm,
you'd,
mm-hmm,
get 50 square foot per floor.
If I match the other side, I'll have an interior, though, that's 3 feet shorter. So the master bedroom's essentially going to be 10 feet wide. So by the time you put a bed in there, you won't, and a dresser or a armoire, what have you, you won't have any room to walk.
Where are they sleeping now?
In the existing bedroom.
Sheldon,
yeah,
and then Hank after.
Yeah, let me suggest here that I'm reluctant to step on the on what the zoning board does. And I think these kinds of things, and whether I'm not commenting one way or another, whether it would meet the criteria that the zoning board has to consider in terms of permitting a variance, and I am the liaison to the zoning board for the planning commission, but I cannot sit on, I cannot comment, I cannot participate in a decision relating to something that the planning commission has already addressed, and there's no talking out of school, so I'm not going to influence the decision in any manner like that. Let me suggest, and maybe this is just a variation of what you said, Andy, is that there's nothing in our criteria that addresses the particular needs. All of our needs have to address, pardon me, the individual usage needs that the resident may choose to put the house to.
Mm-hmm.
Our assigned task, and this isn't intended to be words of art, but our assigned task is basically make sure that this house is within the guidelines that have been set up for the consistency of the appearance of the house in the neighborhood. And we do not have any criteria that permits us to address whether there's old people, young people, people in wheelchairs, or anything like that. Now, it's a separate question whether or not the ordinance should address those kinds of considerations, because as it stands now, that's not on the table for us, however sympathetic any of us may be to that, and however close any of us may be to actually having to address those issues ourselves. But let me caution the commission, if I might, to consider the fact that however sympathetic the individual circumstances may be, it's not, I would argue that it's ultra vires. We can't do
that. What does that mean, ultra vires? I know what it means as a lawyer, but I want you to explain what it means.
Well, it would be an unauthorized act on our part, and not authorized by statute, in order to take those matters into consideration as far as the determining the suitability of any particular plan.
And we have also on other homes stated that it is not within our, that we do not take into account the interior usage of the house, the placement of furniture, the things like that.
That's true.
In how we look at the exterior of the home.
Mm-hmm.
We've had several
people who've been quite angry. Like,
yes,
there was one person who wanted to use a wall that had no fenestration for kosher dishes. And, you know, however sympathetic we were, there was a great hue and cry. I think we were blamed on Trump's rise at that time, if I recall. But you know, but we were trying to be very, you know, respectful of the ordinances. Hank, you had something to say.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw something out here, just because, I mean, when looking at the plans, I see perhaps an opportunity. As Mr. Lee has alluded to, that there's only going to be three people living in the house, and that's what it is. Currently, the house has how many bedrooms?
Two, I believe.
It's a two-bedroom house as it sits right now.
Correct.
So the issue is now they're looking at four. If you take a look at the second floor plan for the existing bedroom in the front, it would appear to me that you could simply widen that door that's on the existing bedroom for in to get into.
I know where you're going with I did misspeak when I said three. Okay. Mr. and Mrs. Saporn's daughter is in college and she comes and stays with them.
Okay.
When she's out of college, hence the reason for four bedrooms.
Okay, so that's three bedrooms.
I don't get into how people.
Okay, but I guess
they both have their own room.
That's fine. So for whatever it is, I mean, you're looking at an existing bedroom that could easily be modified for handicap. That wall could be taken out, and the master bedroom could actually be bigger, and then the existing bedroom in the front corner stays. So as a result, if you have two bedrooms right now, you have three bed. You'll end up with three bedrooms, and deal with the handicap access, and you can make this master slash barrier free room into one room that's a little bit smaller that could possibly accommodate the 115 square feet. That's where I was going with that. And there's nothing wrong with the second floor being a little bit smaller than the first floor with the roof around it so that it...
I think your point is, at least the point that I'm inferring, is that there are options, and maybe we should take another month to see whether we can support it wholeheartedly without asking us to approve something that is clearly violative of the standards that we apply every single time without, candidly, again, a level of proof that this is truly necessary, and again, it might not be relevant, it presumably is not relevant, to accommodate the needs of the residents. That's just where I am. Any more conversation that anyone has on this issue before I ask for a vote?
I have a question.
Sure.
Respectfully, not with all due respect.
Yeah.
My take on this was the Planning Commission, I had to bring this before you so this would meet the conformity of the city, of the exterior components. And then if that were the case, and I would have to go to the zoning board and make my case for a variance for a larger size, or we'd have to reduce this. And just for clarification, what I'm understanding is are we tabling this for another month because we're into a zoning issue? Are we tabling this for another month because we're into a planning? Because as far as the elements go, I was under the impression that I was coming because of that, because I needed to conform to exterior elements.
Well, it's kind of both. But the bottom line is we haven't had a vote yet. We haven't had a motion yet. So I'm not exactly sure what people are doing. But from my point of view, I don't feel comfortable voting for it to even move to the ZBA given the overage, because I've never voted that way before. And I don't know that this panel ever has, at least since I've been part of it. So what I would feel comfortable voting for is to table it so you have another chance to shave it a little bit so it's not over the house size limit. But again, there's no motion that has been presented, and I guess I'm going to ask whether anyone wants to make a motion.
To answer your question, I think maybe a little more straightforwardly, there is a section in our guidelines that says the house size, square footage, and lot coverage do not exceed the maximum allowed by city code. So you're asking for a house that exceeds that. Am I correct?
But what I was asking was, is that in the planning side?
Is this in the planning, or is that in the ZBA?
Would that be in the zoning board side?
That's part of our process.
That's why I was trying to clarify.
Sorry for not being clear.
Yeah.
Anyway, does anyone want to make a motion about where we are? I mean.
Well, let's ask the gentleman, does he want.
Yeah.
Does he want this table? Does he want.
Yeah. What's your preference, sir?
Obviously, I've got 10 months of my life tied up in this, mm-hmm. right? Four plans, numerous trips. Searching out building materials, going back and forth. I've consulted with Hank. He's been more than helpful on every single aspect of it. I've ran down surveys. I've ran down the architect. I've got a lot tied up into this to get it to this point. Obviously, I would love to get it through the planning and then go before the zoning, but if it's not going to go that way and tabling it is going to help, I'm for whatever we can do. But again, I've got my life tied up, and in addition, I've built hundreds of these without having to do what I've done here. I built 1,000 dormers in Taylor and Romulus and E-Course. I've never even had to go before zoning board.
Yeah.
It was like, you know.
It's a unique community with unique requirements.
And I have no issue with that.
Yeah.
I understand you want to maintain the integrity
yeah.
of the community and you want to maintain the likeness of the community. I get that wholeheartedly.
I think that what you've listened to tonight are, you know, two concerns, one dealing with house size and one dealing with the brick and the hardy. You know, and there's also the fenestration and the setback. So what you're right, just that there's more than two. But what I would suggest that you do, if you were to feel comfortable with a tabling as opposed to a vote, is to continue to consult with Hank. We totally know how hard this has been and how unusual it is for you. You have to hopefully respect, I think, what I'm hearing from the commission, which is we have to have allegiance to the guidelines and the ordinances that we're to enforce, and as opposed to punting it simply to the ZBA. And I personally feel bad about the frustration. I feel bad about the fact that someone being a resident is going to be physically incapacitated as well. So would you feel comfortable with a table and giving it another shot for another month?
I would feel comfortable with whatever I could do to get the plan approved at this point.
I think that's probably the most... I think if you work with Hank, he gave a good idea about how to kind of reduce it up top. It might be something that would be very productive use of your time the next month. But that's just my opinion. Does anyone want
to... Move the table.
Second.
Any discussion on the motion to table? Okay. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? It's unanimous. And again, sorry for your frustration.
Well, it is what it is. I mean, I want to be within conformity of what you require, but I do have a lot of time and a lot of effort tied up in it.
That's clear. It's totally clear.
I mean, it's a large project, but yet it's a frustrating one.
Yep. We appreciate that, sir. Very much. I just thought you would jump on it. Okay. Then the next matter is the matter of consideration of the addition at 26001 Aller. And if you could identify yourself, sir. And I think to start off the conversation, so we're as efficient as possible with our time, this is not the first time you've been before us, clearly. We had concerns that were very clearly stated about the dormer and the size and the location, among a couple other things. And I'd like to hear how you address that and how you, or whether you interacted with Hank to satisfy yourself that we were not going to be repeating the problems that we've had the last time. As part of your presentation.
Yes, Mark Lederman, good evening, commissioners. Basically, we went back to the drawing board, listened to the comments, and we rescaled everything and reduced the size of the dormer and the location of the dormer. So what we submitted is a showing exactly what we did. We have a comparison how we reduced the size of the dormer. We reduced it 20%. We lowered the pitch. Reduced the size of the window. We centered the dormer on the window below. So we tried to make it, so it is not as dominant as we originally submitted. We showed you the comparison. So we rescaled it. We withdrew a good scale down. And we addressed literally the proportionality of the dormer to the size of the home.
Okay, just before the conversation begins again and before I turn it over to Hank, did Hank during his discussions with you give you any opinion as to what you've done, is likely to satisfy the concerns that were
made by the commission the last time out?
Yes, we discussed it, Hank, on several occasions. I was bringing everything to Hank from the very beginning, showing him exactly what we did. We talked about the size of the dormer, and we talked a lot about the last meeting. The concerns that I heard from the last meeting was that the proportion of the dormer to the rest of the house was too big, that it, your eye was drawn to the dormer. There was, it clearly, as far as I'm reading the ordinance, complies as far as the ridge size, the relationship, the consistency to the rest of the house, to the rest of the area, the neighbors. So I think that this is consistent and complies with everything on the ordinance, with the exception, possibly, of the proportionality. And that, in my mind, is a subjective thing. I mean, what I think is proportional, you may not think is proportional. But we feel that this dormer complies with everything that I can read in the ordinance. I don't see anything that it doesn't comply with. We did talk a little bit about the transom window. Again, Haynes said there may be some concerns that the transom window doesn't belong, doesn't fit right. I said that I personally think it does. I think it gives a little uniqueness, a little updated look to this bungalow. But again, that's my opinion, and I think a lot of people share that feeling, and you may not. That's what I'm here for. I'm here to get this approved, and that we could all live with, and we're all satisfied. But as far as your question, Mr. Chairman, about did I work with Hank? Did I talk to Hank? Yes, and I think we've done what the commission asked for, reducing the size, reducing the fact that it was too big and too top heavy at the beginning in the original drawing. It has been scaled back, it has been reduced, it has been centered over the window below. And we feel it's consistent with the rest of the house and the area. So I welcome your comment. I'm here to get this approved so we can build this dormer. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that you could approve it. If there's some comments or suggestions or feelings of the commission, I'd be happy to discuss it and work something out.
Okay. Any further comments, sir? Okay. Hank.
Yes, sir.
I have one thing.
Sure.
Is there going to be a public address if you miss it? There's somebody, a neighbor here. I don't know if you want to hear his comments.
Yeah, we'll get his comments after Hank.
Okay.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Thank you. Hank?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Mr. Lederman did allude to, we have had different conversations. I did explore with him the possibility of using different types of roof structures that might call less attention to the dormer. I did reiterate to him the concern about the transom window. He does show a sloped ceiling on the inside, which is why he would want the transom window to allow more light. If it was a flat ceiling, the transom window wouldn't work in there. But that's basically what this is. I mean, it's a siding, which I assume he'll match the same James Hardy type of cementitious siding that he planned to use on the rest. The 5040 window will supply him with an egress for the front as far as that goes. But again, the concerns were, he did make it smaller. He did knock a foot off of each side. And he did center it over the bay window. But again, the concerns were the type of roof, the height of the roof, the height of the dormer, as opposed to the size, as it related to the size in the transom window. Other than that, the rest of the project's already been approved. This is what this is all he's here for.
Okay. Thank you, Hank. Any public participation? Sir, can you identify your name and address?
My name's Barry Friedman. I live at 13345 Lincoln. Property in question here is directly, the side of it is directly out my front window. So two things. Number one, 2 months ago I came to this meeting because it was the first meeting to discuss the plans for the house, and I had never met Mr. Reedman before, but I came to the meeting because I wanted to know what's going to be right across the street from me. And pretty much, if I recall, the plan was to build basically a box on the back of the house. And you guys kind of went at them pretty hard. And what has come of it is really very nice looking. all the angles, all the shapes, the windows. So I appreciate what you guys did back 2 months ago. It's actually looking very nice. The last month I came back again when you weren't happy with the size of the dormer. And I guess at that point I was kind of confused as to why that was a problem. I know he's downsized it now, which I guess is okay. But I was kind of confused as to why that was an issue. Several of the members of the commission seemed to focus on the fact that it was anybody looking at the front of the house was going to automatically have their eyes taken to the dormer. And I guess that's probably true. I mean, I've seen houses with dormers and they catch your eye. But I really was kind of confused as to why exactly that was an issue. I've seen the plans now for the smaller dormer, and I guess I kind of have a better idea as to why that was the case, because it doesn't draw your attention as much as the big dormer did. I live around the corner. I'm not going to be one of those people who's going to see the dormer day after day, necessarily. But I know that what he's done in the back looks really good, so I'm pleased with that, and I thank you guys for making that happen.
Thank you, sir. Anything else from any member of the public on this site plan? Okay, public participation is closed. I will start with Aaron.
I would say that the proportionality of the dormer now has reached my sensitivity to the design element drawing your eye away, and I'm satisfied with it. I have to say I'm impressed with your dedication to that transom window. We'll see how that goes.
Okay, thank you.
I wasn't here at the last meeting, so I didn't know about these issues, but seeing the scaled back version definitely looks better on paper, so if Aaron's satisfied, I'm satisfied.
Martha.
I appreciate your downsizing the proportion of the dormer. I'm disappointed that you still have chosen to do the kind of gable style. I was kind of hoping you would try out maybe more of a shed roof style where it comes out. You know, the house in the front has a nice horizontal design to it. It's created by the skirting of the brick across the left side and the bank of windows and the stone on either side of them. So that horizontal feel, that's what I'm looking at. It's carried through to the bay window on the right side, and then all of a sudden it's, boop, here's this peep up here. And that is exacerbated by the transom window, which doesn't relate to anything else on the original house style or what you are going to be doing with the house style. So I still have an issue with it, but I commend you for doing so much extra with the redesign of the back, and I do appreciate your centering the dormer that you have and making it smaller. It's better than it was.
Jill.
I would like to also express my appreciation for you shrinking the dormer. I find it to be not quite as distracting as it was before. I do still find it with the style of roof. I kind of agree with Martha that with the style of roof that you have, and specifically the half-round transom window, it is still a little jarring to me. I think the thing that I find the most disconcerting is that half-round transom window up above. I understand that you want to bring more light in, but it's a design element that actually isn't in any other place in the house. So when you look across the front of that house, you do have these design elements that are very square and rectangular. You've got the rectangular pieces on the details on the door. The windows are square, rectangular. You do have the bay. But there's nothing that has that round in it. And again, I understand that you feel that you're trying to give it an updated twist, but it really is a 1940s bungalow. And a 1940s bungalow would never have a half-round transom window in it. It's just not what would be there. And so my point of view is that I do like to stay a little bit more true to the actual style of the home. And I find that when you try and add these unique and different and, in my mind, kind of a 1980s add to the house, it's jarring. That is my opinion. So I appreciate you shrinking the dormer down. I actually agree with Martha that a shed roof gives you that more the horizontal feel, which I think would be more attractive on this. But again, that's my opinion. And I have my opinion and you have yours. But I think the transom window doesn't help it from a design perspective. And it's very much not in keeping with the fact that it actually is a 1940s bungalow. And why do people want to change the fundamentals of the house? So I think you've done a very nice job on the back, though, and I appreciate what you did. But I would like to see that same care roll over into the front and into that dormer.
I'd agree with Jill and Martha. In my opinion, you're trying to put a dormer where a dormer doesn't belong, and especially in that style, the design's off on it. The proportion's better, it's centered, but it still looks, in my opinion, tacked on. The window's wrong, the shape is wrong, and it's not consistent with the house. It just isn't. And you, from what I understand, you're not gaining anything. A 7x7 interior space is not going to have a ton of function. I think if you're committed to having a dormer there, a shed style roof is going to make a lot more sense. But again, I'm going on record saying I think you're trying to put a dormer where a dormer doesn't belong.
Sheldon, oh, thank you. You finished?
Yep.
Thank you, Sheldon.
I don't have the same aesthetic sensibilities as some of the other members of this commission, and I give them their due on what they know how to do. I'm satisfied, and I think we've eaten this guy's heart out enough already. Is that a professional opinion?
It's in a meaningful opinion. Mayor?
I'm happy with the downsized dormer. I think that helps a lot to the issue. I agree with what has been said that the half round transom window doesn't make any sense.
Thank you. I totally identify with Sheldon's comments. I mean, we've put you through the meat grinder here. But you've been pretty stubborn and kind of not listening to the concerns of the commission, so it's kind of a two-way street, if you don't mind my saying it that way. I have this fear that when we approve this, with or without the transom, it is going to be noticed as a house that looks, because of the front, just off. And there is, you know, the principle of proportionality that we are supposed to be paying close attention to. And I just don't want to cast a vote for something that in a year from now, people are going to look at and say, what did we do? In violation of the proportionality principle. And again, I don't see why the dormer is necessary. I'm concerned about the transom window too, but this is one of those ones where I just worry whether you're so outside the box in terms of the positioning of the dormer and still the size, although it has been scaled back, that, and again, I don't see the utility of it, that I think you're asking us to vote on something that, you know, people could regret later on. But again, that's just a personal perspective. I totally identify with what Sheldon said, which is, you've been here three times, this is the fourth, and you know, when is enough enough? But I'm very torn.
Can I say something?
Sure, of course.
Well, first of all, the dormer, again, the need for the dormer is there. We need the dormer for size to sell it, to market this. It is, you know, consistent. I see dormers all over the city.
But not like that.
They're all over the city, everywhere I look. There's not a street that I go down in Huntington Woods that does not have a bungalow with dormers. And they are gable dormers. And this gable's consistent with the other gables on the house. So
off to the side like that?
Yeah.
I would guess those people didn't come in front of us, though, and say, we need this to flip the house.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's not a good thing to hear.
That's not the right thing to say.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You've heard the term shoot yourself.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. I think, personally, look, I'm here to work this out and make a deal. If the transom window is bothering me, if we could find a compromise, if the transom is bothersome for you, if they think that unduly affects the proportionality of it, I'm here to make a compromise. We need to get this approved. But
we, sir, with all due respect, expressed our concern about that dormer very strongly, and it's still here. And it does violate the principle of proportionality. And I ask the question, you know, are you, you know, exacerbating the problem by being somewhat obstinate? I don't know, because this body has to exercise its, you know, its discretion, but its discretion is informed by the guidelines. The guidelines talk about proportionality. We've told you our concern repeatedly about the location and the size of the dormer. You've scaled it back somewhat, but I don't recall approving something like that, and I'll be very candid. When I saw this plan again presented in this light, I said, whoa. Is there a failure to communicate? Because I just don't know why you're going back to the same well. That's like a dry one, in my opinion. Now, I feel what Sheldon is saying is very legitimate, but I don't feel comfortable voting for it.
Sir, I would tell you that when you looked at us and said, I need this dormer to sell this house, I don't actually believe that. I think that if you do a very nice job on the rear of this house, that extra 7 by 7 feet is not going to sell this house. I think an attractive design with something that is not jarring to the eye is going to sell your house, and it's going to do it very well for you. And I think that you seem to have this thing that, you know, I've got to have this little bit of extra square footage in order to sell this house. The thing is that you will sell this house, and you will leave here, and you won't come back. But we will be here, and we will be living here, and we will see that house. And I drive past it every single day, and I'm very pleased with what you're doing on the back of it. But I don't think that you need that dormer to sell that house. I think that is a little bit of an exaggeration. Okay. And I think that is really the wrong tact for you to come to us and say, hey, I'm trying to maximize as much as I can get out of this to make the maximum amount of money I can get out of this, and whether or not you feel that it'll look good in your neighborhood once I'm gone, I don't care. That's kind of how that came across.
I heard it that way, too.
That is exactly how
I
heard it.
I apologize if it came across that way. It certainly wasn't my intent.
I assumed not, but that is how it came across.
My intent is to make this house as attractive as I can, and I have to consider the interior as well as the exterior.
And
when you have a small bedroom with a 3x3 existing window with no other light than the master bedroom, that is problematic for a lot of buyers.
I think that perhaps you might want to think about adding more windows into the house as it already exists, then, if you need more light into that room.
Well, I'm talking about the master bedroom. I'm talking about the master bedroom.
I saw that.
Yeah.
I know what you're talking about.
There's really...
It's a bungalow, so typically a bungalow has that one little window up in there because that was originally attic space.
Yeah.
And you're turning it into something that it wasn't originally, and you may have to rethink maybe the window structure in the original part of the house. I don't know. But what I'm telling you is that, you know, that I don't believe that this addition of this dormer is going to make the house more saleable than it is with a very nicely done addition on the back that you're already heading toward. And I would caution you that trying to push something out there that is really kind of violating what that house actually is originally isn't sitting well with some of us. That's all I'm telling you.
So I think points have been made. I'm happy to entertain a motion if anyone wants to make one.
Is this appropriate to make a compromise here on the window itself? If there's something
The window is secondary personally for me. It's that dormer in that location that I think violates the principle of proportionality that makes it very much stand out in a way that, as Jill said, when you've sold the house,
I think the neighbors are going to be looking and kind of scratching their head for a long time. And that's the, I mean, look, I'm not an architectural expert, but I haven't seen this before. I don't see the need for it. The transom is not the thing that's driving my opinions. I can't speak for anyone else.
There was a hip on this, if we had a hip on this, in lieu of the gable. I mean, the hip would certainly maybe allay your concern about drawing your eye to it, a hip. I mean, I have a picture of a hip that you may, it's, you know, I don't know, it's a, can I pass these out and show you what the hip looks like?
You're more than welcome to. Thank you for showing us that. Does anyone want to make a motion at this time about this particular site plan application?
Mr. Chairman, just for a point of clarification, if the motion does come forward, any changes or alterations in the roof or the transom window should be reflected in the motion if it's the inclination of the Planning Commission to approve it without those features. So I just want clarification.
I'll make a motion.
Sure.
I move to deny. Second.
Is there any discussion regarding this motion? Seriously? I mean, this is a tough one because the gentleman has been before us several times, but, you know, the fact that the record is already complete. Does anyone wish to discuss this any further? Okay. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 All those opposed?
Aye.
It's 4-4. Sorry. What?
The motion to deny fails.
Oh, you're right.
Right.
You're right, it does.
Right.
So
now that doesn't mean approval.
Right.
No.
So if anyone wants to...
It just means that you need a subsequent motion.
I would like to make a motion to approve the design that he's given us with the hip roof instead, and with... excuse me. Hank mentioned that the siding would be the same material
yes.
as on the other. Okay. All right. I'll take your word for that. But I would like to suggest we approve it with the hip roof in lieu of the roof that's shown on the plans that was previously submitted.
Okay, is there a second for that?
How about discussion?
The second, then we'll discuss.
Second.
Discussion?
I just want to point out that when you're going to put a hip roof on there, that is going to increase the visual weight up there, which changes it immensely. If you're willing to change the type of roof you're going to have for a dormer, you need to be going to a shed roof. It's the lightest version that you can get for a dormer, and especially for this particular style of house if you're going to have a dormer. That's just my opinion.
Okay. Any further discussion on the motion, Hank?
Yeah, just one point. Should the design end up with either a hip or a shed roof, that would negate the transom window.
Right.
Just by the structural.
If it's a shed roof, I don't know. I really think it's not necessary.
Well, I know that, but I don't think it's something they've got.
Can we share the discussion?
So.
Yes, the question is, if the motion were substituted to have a shed roof rather than the hip, would people be willing? I think, in light of what Martha said, I'd be willing to move this thing along to vote on a motion that talks about a shed roof rather than what was currently presented.
I'd like to see him come back with the design as
here,
such.
I one of those too.
Well, you've been holding out on us. And see, here's the issue with the relationship. You know, this is third time around. You're holding out on us.
Because now it's become bigger.
Yep.
No.
Yeah, it is.
It may not be.
It's wider.
It may not be the scale.
Well, that's, you know,
he's got it tied up all the way to the top.
Yeah, my, I don't have got something I can, I got enough trouble with this stuff as it is. I've got something I can look at in front of me with a minimal of, yeah, but except for, and maybe I'll change that. I, as far as I'm concerned, my motion stands the way I
The way I vote on it. Okay, any further discussion on the motion?
I'm no design expert. That hip doesn't do a thing to improve it, in my opinion.
Okay.
In fact, it looks worse, I'm sorry to say.
Okay.
But we're voting on the hip.
Oh, well, we're on the hip.
Sorry,
we're on the hip.
We're on the hip.
All those in favor of Sheldon's motion to approve, subject to it having a hip roof on it, say aye.
Aye.
That's two. All those opposed, say nay.
Nay.
That's six. Do we want to try? Well, look,
I'll
think.
I will try. Can I try?
Okay.
Aaron? Make it happen.
In my opinion,
okay.
I agree that this is a little bit wider. It's centered. I think it addresses the weighting concern. I would propose that it be accepted as is, as a hip roof dormer design.
That's not a hip roof.
A
shed.
A shed.
Shed.
Roof. Thank you. As a shed roof dormer
as
design.
Presented.
As presented.
Yeah. Okay. Any discussion on the plan that we've been just now presented with? With the shed roof.
You need a second.
No, second. Anyone have a second for this one?
Second.
Okay, we got a second.
Just so I understand, you're talking about
that one
with the three windows in it?
Yes.
And Mr. Chairman, I'm going to need a copy of that because I don't have it for the record, so I'm going to need. Thank you.
May God help the people on Allard.
Thank
but because we're winging this. Okay, so was there a second for the shed roof motion?
David.
Okay. Any discussion?
Yeah, I think we still have a proportion issue. Now we've got a proportion issue between the top of the bay window and the bottom of this shed design. That proportion is completely off now, and you've also got a proportion issue on where you're tying the shed roof in to that main ridge.
Yeah, where is it tied into the main
peak.
Ridge? Is it tied into the peak?
Peak.
It's tied in at the peak, and typically it would be tied in lower.
Yeah.
She also places the window really high up.
Yeah.
Could we make those in the motion? Could we lower the
now we're designing on the fly again, and that is such a bad idea.
Yeah.
That is such a bad idea.
I you know what? I think what you've heard is a forming consensus. Don't shake your heads, please, sir, because we were here and we've talked about this issue repeatedly, and you chose to ignore our counsel and advice.
So without due respect, sir, I haven't ignored your advice at all. It was my understanding that you were taking exception to the proportionality in the size of the dormer. So
okay.
Maybe I misunderstood.
Okay.
I did not ignore what
yeah.
your wishes
there's,
were.
There's no need. You're right. I should not have suggested it like that. I think you have heard, slowly but surely, a consensus begin to emerge about having an appropriately designed shed roof as the possible compromise solution to this, so you could have a majority of this commission vote to move this thing along. We don't have a motion that has passed yet. I would suggest that, you know, we give another try with that shed roof with close consultation with Hank, who understands this body extremely well, and see whether or not next time we can quickly move beyond this with a consensus.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, and again, Mr. Lederman can weigh in on this. Could I, if it was the inclination of the commission not to pass this tonight and look for a plan, could I suggest that they offer him a table so that he doesn't have to renotice and repay and do that
again? Of course.
That's just it. I mean, you know, if it's the inclination not to pass this, then, you know, perhaps you might wish to table it rather than to deny it so that he can make his changes.
What do we do if we stay deadlocked forever? You know, 4-4, how do we get
out? Next year, it can't be bad.
The other concern is that if we table it, it would be 2 months before we can even get back to this, because you're already filled up on the April meeting.
We may be, but we could ask the Planning Commission at this point to suspend the rules to allow this particular project to come back.
To the extent I have any discretionary input here, I would be more than happy to do that.
You have the option of with the commission here, you can do that. To suspend the rules.
Aaron has something to say.
I was going to say, judging by the feedback of the council, I respectfully withdraw my proposal.
Is that the right way to say it?
Withdraw my motion.
Motion. Thank you, Jill.
Okay. So.
And.
What do you, have another motion that you'd like to make?
No, I think I'm done for right now.
Oh, man.
I'll make a motion to table.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay, it's tabled. Hopefully you'll work very closely with Hank. I think you've heard the consensus emerging. You'll get on the schedule for next month. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda. Oh, okay. Okay, I'm going to take a restroom break too. Can I take 2 minutes, Hank?
Aaron already did.
Mr. Chairman, if you wanted to declare a 2 minute recess or a 3 minute
recess. 2 minute
recess,
okay?
Do that.
Back to order. The next item on the agenda is the we're missing Martha. Never mind. We'll wait. Okay, here we go. Back on. The next item on the agenda is the matter of consideration of the proposal for an addition to 26426 Huntington. Ben?
My client, Mr. Rob Wine's going to just say hello first.
Just want to quickly introduce myself. Don't want to take up too much more of your time. I appreciate you gathering tonight to review the plan. I would apologize for not being here. She's home with children. I am a lifelong resident of Huntington, born and raised here. My parents, my grandparents. So I'm third generation. My children are now fourth generation. I am currently in my second house. This will be my third house in Huntington Woods, and hopefully this will be my last house in Huntington Woods. So I've been working with Ben Heller to come up with what we think is a fantastic plan for an addition here, and hopefully you guys agree. Thank you.
And I'll step up just to kind of take my time and explain so everyone understands exactly what we did. And one thing I'll comment on is originally Rob brought me in to, when he bought the house, it came with some plans that had been approved that were old. And I was thinking about it tonight, I should have had those to show you because this is, when I reviewed them with him, I was able to show him all the things you were talking about tonight, the porch and the massing in the back. You actually have them here. If you guys have some interest, you can see that this is, you're looking at the back of the addition, and you can pass these around. They basically, you'll see there's like this odd shed roof that just kind of comes off the side of the house on the back, and the dormer in the front portion isn't nearly what we've done here, and you'll see that as you take a look at the, you can pass that around that particular page. He engaged us to redesign the plan and to get everything correct. And so basically what we're trying to do here is we designed a plan that meets the square footage, that meets the lot coverage. So we are within that. It has a small corner that is pre-existing non-conforming, but because unlike the last project where the property actually, as we built the addition to the rear, it encroaches a little bit further. We actually stepped the addition in. So what we've done does not require any variances. So again, we meet all the requirements as far as height, as far as lot coverage, square footage, and there are no variances required for this project. But basically what we've done is we have added on to the rear of the house. The existing house is essentially like here, and the existing garage, the only alteration that we're making to the front of the house is the existing front entry garage has 2 8-foot doors, and it just, their vehicles, they've tried getting them in and out of those 8-foot doors. Obviously, it's additional expense they didn't want to have to incur because it's a nice looking front, we liked it, but the only way we could get their vehicles to work was to put a single car garage door in the opening. So we did alter that, and then we added the dormer and a chair front in the front. And then you can see on the side elevation, unlike the previous plan where they ran and they didn't put brick on the top, we did a two-story brick element is what you'll see when you're coming up the street. And then this steps back and is tucked behind the house, the master closet. And then you come along here and we created a brick arch for a side entry. And then you come around the back,
and that same, you have an arch here and an arch here to enter into a rear entry, and then and we stepped everything in on the upstairs, so the entire second story addition in the back is tucked in behind the house, and we added a brick fireplace on the one side, brick the entire main level, and then just got, you know, made everything symmetrical and in proportion in the back, and tried to repeat the same type of windows and create a good space plan for them. And I guess with that, I would turn it over to any questions, and I guess for Hank to make his part.
Thank you, Hank. I mean, thank you, Ben. Hank?
Yes. This is really kind of an interesting project because, as Mr. Heller alluded to, there was a project approved for this house in the distant, in not too distant past, that had really nowhere near the elements that he's proposed for this. Typically what you see on the front of the house is when you go through with these plans, is you see anything that's stepped back automatically would have siding on it. Mr. Heller has chosen to actually do the engineering to carry the weight of the brick on the front wall and then have only the dormer projection be sided so that it gives a better use of the materials and sets off the siding and maintains the brick, which is unique because really you don't see many people coming before you to do that. He's also gone ahead and added shutters on that to match what's existing. Another interesting feature that he did do is when you take a look at the garage door that he's proposed, in the interest of saving their car mirrors, which I assume was a problem, if you take a look at the pattern that he's showing on the door, it's not far off from the mutton patterns on the front of the house. So there's consistency for the entire front of the house, which you don't typically see. As you go around the house, as he alluded to, what you do see is the back of the house, which is siding because of the weight factor, is set back in. There are windows on all elevations. It meets the height, meets the setbacks, it meets the front and rear yard setbacks, it meets the lot coverage, it meets the maximum house size. I really don't have anything that I could point out that wouldn't be that. It just so then it does have the issue with the predominant material being all brick. But again, he stepped it in on the back, and then on the front, he engineered it so that he'll have brick in a space where we don't normally see it. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. I'm sure Mr. Heller can as well.
Thank you, Hank. Any member of the public wishing to make a comment about this site plan application? Okay, public participation is open and closed. We'll start with the mayor.
Thanks for a great plan. I have no issues with it. Thank you.
I'm going to say I like it, but I'm going to wait to see what Martha says.
Thank you for bringing good design to Huntington Woods, and thank you for paying for it.
Thank you.
No issues. Love it.
Happy.
Outstanding. It's probably the way it should have been designed in the first place. Well done.
Thank you.
I like it.
No issues.
Wonderful, thank you. And you're right across the street. So, boy, that's good news.
Your property value just went up.
Yeah. Zillow notice coming up. Okay, do I have a motion?
I move to approve as presented.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Ben, for your great work.
Thank you for your time.
Okay. The last item on the agenda is public participation. Thank you.
Thanks for making that a little
easier
tonight.
Does anyone wish to present any concerns in our public participation section of the meeting? Okay, with that, we'll close that and take a motion for adjournment. Or adjournment. Anyone?
Move to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
We're out of here. Thanks.